Thank you. Now, I thought that we're recording, in case you wonder what this mic is for, although I don't think I'm ready to record yet, or probably America isn't ready. But anyway, now, I want to, we'll have an executive here from Disneyland Records, and I wanted to mention that because Brubeck made an album called, Brubeck plays Disney. We're going to call it Brubeck at Disneyland, but then there were a lot of hard boppers in the East that would have said that's where he belongs, you know, that group of critics. So they called, I know. So anyway, Disneyland, if you haven't been there, I just want to say a word about it, is this kind of Sodom and Gomorrah in Anaheim, if you haven't been down there. And it's pretty exciting. Oh, you didn't see that part? Oh, it's in back of the rocket. So anyway, that's right, you can park the adults there while the kids go on out of the ball. Anyway, Disneyland, Disney is a wonderful man, and he's on television every week, and he has a program called Walt Disney Presents, and on the show, he has this film, which is a preview of a film that will later be shown in a theater, and last week, it was a film of people going into the park at Disneyland to get into the theater to see one of his television films, of people going into a theater to see one of his films, about, you know those things he does? The first time I saw Disney was on the Mickey Mouse Club, which is the weekday show. I haven't seen the evening show. I don't feel I'm ready yet to go. Because on the evening show, he has the history of the United States, which he got a franchise to from the Congressional Library. And he has people like Johnny Tremaine and Paul Revere and Tom Paine, which I felt was a mistake. But see, Disney doesn't know anything about that because, you know, he's been with animals mainly and doesn't know anyway about politics and all, you know, and the left and all. Anyway, so Walt Disney was on, the way I found the Mickey Mouse Club was I was at home, see, and I was watching Mayor Polson on television. He's our leader downtown. And he was talking about smog, and he was talking about fallout within the smog, you know. And we have a lot of smog, as you know, you can tell. And he said that there's fallout within it, coming from Nevada, and that the government should do something about it because of strontium 90 and future generations and all that. And he said that the government should do something because the tests are in Nevada, and it would be under interstate commerce, you know, or the Mann Act, someone suggested. So to make it more interesting to people. So Disney said, Disney doesn't come into this till later. Mayor Polson said that the government should do something about these tests, you know, so then, because it was double danger within the acid and the smog. So the government didn't do anything about it, but Polson said there's no telling what will happen if they keep testing these bombs every other day in Nevada, see? So he kept talking about mutations and all that jazz, so I figured, you know, it was kind of like left-wing propaganda. And, you know, and I have that attitude about the tests. I dig them because I think they're good for business, right? And I feel the United States is going to go ahead with bomb tests in synagogues and schools, right? Anyway, so... Anyway, I dig the tests, and I've always had that position that, you know, I'm not planning a large family anyway, right? So then, so while this is happening, you know, he keeps talking about mutations, and I said, well, you know, enough of this Buck Rogers jazz. So then Polson was on, I was on Channel 7, see, the American Broadcasting Company. Then a station break comes at 4:45 he was on, and at 5 o'clock, the Mickey Mouse Club comes on by this strange coincidence, and these kids come on who are in the Mickey Mouse Club with these paper mache hats, and they have these ears made in the shape of their idol there, Mickey Mouse. They have this kind of ritual in which they pay this reverence to this rodent who is their leader. So they're all standing, well, you know, it's all right, as long as they believe in something. So they're all joining arms, and they're singing M-I-C-K-Y. The only thing is, like, 500 kids, and if you've seen it before, you know, if you're like a mother and you have that every night, it doesn't bother you. But if you haven't seen these kids before, I ought to warn you that it might shake you up a little, with these ears especially. And you might not be aware that they're paper mache, and you might think, maybe they ought to stop these tests after all. Boy, eerie, huh? Very weird. So then Disney came on, and he told what they were trying to do at the park and how he's tied up with the American Broadcasting Company, which owns 17% or something of Disneyland, the amusement park. And he told a lot of things down there about some of the things they have, and they have a safe driving course in which, you know, you can go out the Santa Ana Freeway there, which is part of Disneyland, the freeway itself. And when you go in there, I saw a great accident on the Santa Ana Freeway near there where a Volkswagen hit a dog, and it seems the dog walked away, you know, one of those. Anyway, the car was like ironed out. Anyway, so Disney came on, and he talked a lot about brotherhood and everything, and he talked about the citizenship program during the summer in which they have kids act as guides at Disneyland, you know, instead of delivering papers or something. So they have kids, you know, the mean age is about 8, and they act as guides because the other kids visiting the park have more faith in them, and then they can lead them through the park. And a lot of good kids, you know, who are learning citizenship, some of them. by working, whereas others have become involuted and bitter by working. And we're saying a lot of things that weren't planned for the air to Mr. Disney, like, when are you going to let the union in? You know, and a lot of that. So, which I think is unfair because he doesn't know anything about that. You know, he's been with animals mostly. So, you know, the only time he ever had any union troubles was in 1947 when they had a strike in the industry and people were striking at his studios in Burbank, and his artists didn't know how to strike because they're inanimate. So they went out, right? They went out and drew pickets on his wall, right? And then he went out and drew Burbank policemen beating them. So anyway, it was very, with tear gas on, very interesting, labor relations. So anyway, he talked about brotherhood on the show, Disney, and then he had his good dramatic values, and he had these kids with these t-shirts on, which are sold in the park for $1.50, which is cost, I understand. And they have his characters on them, like Donald Duck and Goofy, and Mickey Mouse for some of the retarded people, and if the others, he has, like, you know, Davy Crockett and all those people, and Brer Rabbit, which is a corruption of brother. It's a regional dialect indulged in by groups, minority groups, that have been kept into a cultural lag in these ghettos through a lack of enlightenment. Anyway, so they have these t-shirts, and then one kid was waiting out at the water fountain with a plain t-shirt his mother bought at the Broadway, and Disney was saying that they should play with him anyway, which I thought was pretty wild. You know, because he said, at Disneyland, we don't penalize a kid, you know, if his mother is an agnostic, which is great. So, which, anyway, I'm not going to talk about this all night. It was just something I was thinking about. Anyway, onward. I thought, I hope you all made out with a traffic check. That's what I want to talk about for a minute. I was in a roadblock over Christmas, and I hope you scored at Christmas, and you heard the president on FM. Did you hear him? Well, he was up there in the satellite. You heard him, and he was saying, get me down? No, anyway, he was... The president was up there, and you could hear it if you have an FM tuner, or you were in Dolores Drive-In next to a speaker. Anyway, or in drive-in movies. You're going to hear them in stratified areas if you have a rabbit's ear. Anyway, the president was up wishing everybody a Merry Christmas, and I was at this Christmas party where they had a stainless steel tree. You like that for emotionalism? A stainless steel tree from iMagnon and Company with detachable branches so you can store it for the years ahead, right? If the Mongol hordes don't come and take away our holiday on horseback. And what else? Oh. With a plastic star. So anyway, so then I got sick and mononucleosis, which is a student's disease. So I went to see this doctor and he said to me, you ought to go to Palm Springs because there isn't any sun here. So then we got into a big debate about why the sun isn't here and the atom bomb and why it changes the weather and other folklore. So then I went to Palm Springs, which I'd never been to before, this wonderful city which is built under a mountain so the sun goes down at noon. Anyway. Are they serious? No, no. Those people have got a lot of courage. They're carving out a nation in the desert. So then I'm down in Palm Springs and watching, I was in Desi Arnaz Hotel watching him on television on a set made by Columbia, which he owns stock in. So I kind of felt like a fulfilled person. So I'm coming back and I thought, what can I do to really have a ball? Because I might stop at Disneyland, you know, or do some of the other wonderful, rewarding experiences. It's like, coming up, and they're having this highway check. See, I was out of it. I didn't know what was happening. So they're having this highway check, and I was driving back. And the reason I didn't know about anything is that I was listening to KLAC, which has these six disc jockeys that are on 24 hours, and you have a feeling it's the Hindu wheel of life, you know? You know, this guy says, you know, this is the, you know, the Claude Stroud show. I'll be with you till noon. And then at noon, this other fellow will be with you till 4. And then at 4, this other guy comes on, is on till 8. And then if you write them, you can get permission to go out and eat. And then you can come back. See? So we're coming, this is really getting, so I'm really not interested in politics as much as overthrowing the government, but that's, well, why don't you overthrow the government? Because I can't find it, that's why. True, well, onward. So I'm coming back and I'm going through this roadblock and the highway patrol is out. And as you know, the highway patrol has these, they've got Mercuries now, they used to have Pontiacs, but they're really out of their minds. You know, they won't be happy until their retina detach in low range. They're all out of their minds. They got these cars that really scream. So I got these Mercuries, which are bored out. You'll find out about them if you read Hot Rod Magazine, which has all that in it. It's a very cerebral kind of magazine. So they're all driving along, and they got shotguns. So I went through Banning, you know, this prospector's stop-off. And I got out, and this cop stopped me, and he wanted to know what the story was, and he started reading me off, you know. And I've only had trouble with the municipal police so far. The municipal problem is when I got a ticket, I went down to the city hall, and I got a ticket downtown. This ticket was even more interesting. When I got downtown, well, I was in an Austin Healey. And I had to get out of the car because I was dying because the top was down. And I never had the top up, you know? I can't get the top up. I bought a coat once because I couldn't get it up. So it's really true. What I really like to get is that there's a guy out in Glendale that makes great boots for these cars. You know about out there? He makes these great tonneau covers, as we call them boots, the hippies call them. Anyway, so then, and you can zip them up like kayaks around your neck, you know? Your head sticking out. Oh, it's great. There's a lot of hip people in Glendale. That's also where the guys first learned how to put holes in their mufflers in the bottom and put straight pipes on them and scorch people at safety zones. Right? That's our group. So, it's wild, isn't it? So I didn't tell somebody that I'm becoming an actor. You know, that election really wiped me out. After the election, it wasn't anything to do. A lot of people are panicked because I did a television play and I played a straight part and I did a movie and everybody thought I was giving up my drive here for truth. And it's pretty weird. Actually, I did it because the election wiped me out. There wasn't anything to talk about, you know, because, you know, like we have Utopia. The Democrats are in now and we have Utopia with Byrd and Eastland, Faubus, all the Democrats. And right? And it's terrific. What can go wrong? And all the Southern senators who want to hang the world, you know. Of course you can't, because you wouldn't have a quorum to sit in judgment. But that's, of course, when did they need that? But that's, anyway, my work is done now. I have to ride on to the next nation and foment trouble. I think, so I became an actor. That was my defense. And I made I worked on a television play for CBS, which is they don't know what's happening. But the movie was kind of exciting. Did you see the movie? The movie was called In Love and War, and it was made by Fox, which has made the movie 8 times before under different titles, you know, like Guadalcanal Diary and Halls of Montezuma. It's sort of, they have a grudge against the Japanese at the studio. They really have. I know, because I used to walk on a set and I'd say to the producer, I'd say, Mr. Wald, can't you forget? You know? And he'd say, no, really strong. And he'd make this film. So I knew that, you know, a lot of kids were going to bug if I did anything sort of CD, because I have my own subsidy here. There's no reason to get corrupted. So the deal I made with them legally was stipulated that I would write my own material in the picture, which I did, and which they shot in fidelity to their contract. And then they started cutting it out of the movie when they edited it. And everything is out of it, because I was very cool. I wrote 16 pages of the script, which is a lot, because only 160 pages, the whole script. And I wrote all the scenes. I wrote a lot of the talk within the bounds of Robert Wagner and Jeffrey Hunter, so that we'd get it off me. And so we were all saying, we all play Marines in this thing. And we had a lot of great, crazy jokes going, all about first aid stations for the troops. If you got sick, if you were lucky and got sick overseas, you could go in and get first aid. And we pointed out in the script that you could follow these arrows in that the medics put up to get first aid. Or if you were kind of hip, you could follow the arrows back the other way to see where the action was in the first place. I mentioned that. And then we had one scene where we're leaning on the railing and they cut to this footage of MacArthur leading the troops through the Philippine Sea. And we point out that he's leading the troops through the water, but his original intention was to walk on the water, but Truman had fired him, right? So they cut that out, that one out. So there's nothing in the picture, you know, except I walk off the ship and I get shot, you know, and that's it. So symbol of the futility of war. So we, in order to find out just how the audience would take it, they previewed the movie with my audience, my college folk, and who are all at the post office, as I pointed out earlier. Our people. So they're all, anyway, they previewed it in the Village, you know, which is an approximation of Cal almost, UCLA. And you have an interchangeable activity card there, right? So register in a Village and park in Berkeley. That's what someone said. So anyway, I went to see it at the Village, and my group was in there, all the crew cuts and shirts with Continental kits on the back, and my group. So I sat there in the dark, and the movie came on, and I walk off the ship, and I get shot in the back. So immediately people were talking, you know, as to whether, the enemy is unethical or we were retreating, which no one figured out. And then I start to die, and there's a crazy scene in there. It's almost too much to bear, in which all these Marines take off their helmets while I'm dying. And Johnny Mathis starts to sing these hymns, you know, in the back. So then they all come over, and then this chaplain picks me up as I die. See, because I've been a skeptic all through the picture, kind of a baller, you know. And except when I'm dying, and then I know I better get straight. So I'm dying there, and this chaplain picks me up. When that happened, all up and down the aisle of the theater, I could hear people saying, "Sell out." I could hear it. Right? My audience. So, it's actually, if you look closely at the chaplain's insignia, you could see that he was a Zen Buddhist. Ordained in a coffee house, right? or eject in the coffee house, which is even greater. But anyway, it's pretty weird. And then I die, and of course I had to fight, you know, because the movies have a tendency to compromise, and they had other lines for me when I died. They had the whole thing, you know, with the blood at the side of your mouth, and you say, the chaplain says, "Is there anything you want?" And I was supposed to say, "Yes, I want to get straight with the man upstairs, Henry Luce." And he's a vision. Good, that would have made it, huh? Dramatically valid. So it's a kind of a, anyway, if you become an actor, of course, you have to be anything now, you have to be a New York actor. All the actors out here now, most of them are from New York, but they hate Los Angeles, and that's part of it. And they live in a hotel. They don't want to get to be part of this town and get too comfortable, you know? Get that swimming pool thing, you're through. Won't be creative. So you won't be able to do shows like M Squad and have Gun Will Travel, right? So what they do is they all live in, there are two hotels here, the Montecito and the Chateau Marmont. That's where they live. Because they don't want this town to get to them. So they've been out here 5 years and they're living in a hotel and they're in analysis. And, all right, and they're trying to get straight because they can't, there's this girl who's in analysis from New York who calls them every night and says, "Can I come out for 5 years?" And they keep saying, "Not yet, I'm boxed." That's what the actors always say. And then the girl says, "Why can't you accept me?" And then the guy says, "Because I don't know how to receive." It's all kind of analysis, one-upsmanship. And the actors stay, they all rent cars because they don't want the town to get to them. And then they don't go out of the hotel because if people can see on the street, they won't pay to see in a theater. It's the way they think. And then it's an analogy, and then or a paraphrase, or a distortion. Anyway, and then they go out. The only place they go is at night between 4 and 5 in the morning. They go to the Hughes Market on Highland. That's open all night. And they shop in very Spartan fashion with dark glasses and a shirt with an alligator jumping off. And that's the next stage. Stage two, in which he loses his tail and goes into space. So they go into Leaping Lizards. And then they go into well-read comic strips, newspapers. That kid knows a lot. So then they go in the market and they buy like woolites. They can wash your socks at the hotel. And cashmere socks, woolites, very good. And then they buy instant coffee and a Coke. That's the way they shop. And then when they get the Coke, they go to the checkout stand. The checker says, "Don't you want to take a six pack?" And the actors always say, "Well, no, because I might be going back to New York, you know." Right? Gotta get a play. I gotta get a play. Then if you meet them on the street, if you're lucky, you meet them on the street there between the hotel and the market, then they say to you, "Nothing happens in this town," which is unfair, because that's an unfair allegation. A lot happens in Los Angeles. During the day, you can go to Griffith Park and watch grass grow. It's exciting. And if you have a date, it means more than just being alone, I feel. And then, you know, you need someone to share it with. It's a real experience. And then at night, we have, there are coffee houses. There are 41 coffee houses. There's a new one in Hermosa called the Insomniac. It's open 24 hours, except sometimes they pack it in at 4 because they can't make it. But otherwise, they're open. And there's all kinds of wild coffee houses. They're open till 3, at which time everybody gets up and puts on their sandals and says, "Geez, you know, I really hate to go home, but I've got to get up early and go to Europe in the morning." There's a lot of that. And, okay. And you know, and if finally, if you can't make it anywhere else, you know, if you're really going to the wall, like at 5 o'clock in the morning, you know, you get that thing where you don't know if you want a hamburger or eggs, you know, the real confusion of the Western man, then great ideas of Western man. I don't know if I want a hamburger. So then you can go to Cantor's Delicatessen is open forever. They never close, which is insane. And that really takes a lot of power to stay open all the time. They're, you know, they bring in food, you know, keep bringing the fresh rolls in and changing the light bulbs, you know, with the gripper there and mopping up with ammonia while you're having, you know, sandwich. Boy, so, and, so have that. And then Cantor's never closes. And see, the thing is, I know I begin to sound like a kook. This is for people, you know, who like can't sleep. If you have a home and good relationships and all, you don't need a delicatessen that's open all night. But it's good, you know, for people. Like, you know, I drive down there sometimes just to see if it's open. I really do. I don't go in or anything. I just drive up and I say, you know, "Wow, it's open." Anxiety. Then I drive home, and then I get in a garage, and I think, "I wonder if it was really open. Maybe I better go back." Like analysis. So I'm not in analysis. Everybody thinks I am, but I haven't exhausted reason yet, so I'm still working on that. So I'm going to reject analysis, like, along with the church and the Communist Party. So they're all together against analysis, because it turns you against your folks. All right, anyway, this is something else. So the Cantor's is open all night, and they're going to make a training film. No, you have to hit them together. Then they make more noise. See, you shake them out, it won't get the effect you want. So, remember when guys on Horace Heights show used to play those? Remember? Remember that? The guys used to play the glasses? And they used to get different levels of water. And then they play Some of These Days because there's good changes, right? And, and play faster than Terry Gibbs, which is really doing something. Actually, the fastest you can play is to stay with Bird, and you do that by playing a role, I understand. Excuse me, as an in-group joke. Well, onward. Achieving the group. So anyway, I just want to say as a closing note here before the orchestra arrives that on track five, that we're making a training film about Cantor's being open all the time. It's a science fiction film which opens with two lovers in a parked car. And but they plan to be married, so it's okay. That's for the mothers. And then it's the girls' mothers and boys' mothers. So there's no way out. And then the girl comes out of the clinch and she says, "Bob, my watch has stopped." And then Bob says, "That's funny, my watch has stopped too." And then she says, "Look, the street lights are out." And he says, "That's funny, my ignition is magnetized." And then she says, "Look, Bob, in the sky." And then there's this large spider moving toward the earth. And then he comes down. He's rather outsized for this season. And he crushes the car they're in. See? And then these flames come up. And then the credits come up. And it says, "The day Cantor's closed." Isn't that great? Yeah, I think it's fun. Well, anyway. Now, are there any groups I haven't offended? All right. On the next show, I'm going to talk about psychiatry completely. I'll tell you everything I know. Good? It is a short show. Anyway. Everything I know. You like that? The confessional. The reason I want to do this is because I shopped in Beverly Hills for all the Christmas jazz because nobody else will give me credit except Jax. I want to pay tribute to them for that and also for not having seams on the outside of the trousers. I just found that out. Master of trivia, friend of none. Anyway, the reason I mention this is that I found out there are no doctors in Beverly Hills. All those MDs on Bedford Drive are analysts. And they're trying to cover for the women who are embarrassed, you know. And the women cover themselves by carrying a kid. They say, "I'm taking him to the doctor," see. But they're not. It's really just kind of a thing. So it's like going out in threes, see, socially. So anyway, I think women dig analysis more than men. That may be a generalization. But I do generalize a lot without specific knowledge. And can I tell you about this? The head of psychoanalytic research at Mount Sinai Hospital, at the same hospital that gave you Oscar Levant, kids. The head of psychoanalytic research there said that he liked the way I could focus on a group like advertising men and talk about nailed-down collars and thin ties with stick pins through the body and wrought iron glasses. He said, with a minimal distribution of energy, you focus on their mores and level them. And, of course, what he doesn't know is that I have no specific knowledge of the subject and I generalize and use stereotypes. So if I wasn't perceptive, I could be a bigot. But it's no time for that. He doesn't know. Don't tell him. So anyway, back to our problem. Anyway, so I was going to say, just a closing note, that there are nothing but analysts on Bedford Drive, and that women like them more than men. I mean, they dig it. And because girls, they use analysis in their arguments. Like, instead of throwing out their own argument and getting it hit with a hammer, what they say is, see, they cool it. They always say, "Well, as any analyst will tell you," see? Then they slip the herring in. That's what they all do. So just press them. Don't let them get away with that and tell them that any analyst won't tell you. I mean, he won't tell you for nothing. And he won't tell you right away. But after like 3 years of rapport, then you'll tell him. You tell him. And then he says, "Good going," you know? And then you say, "Thank you, father," right? And then he validates your parking ticket. Right? I want to thank you for individual perception. And to those of you who are group leaders and started the applause, you can act as a rallying point for collective action when I say thank you for the last 30 minutes, and I'll see you in about an hour. One and all. Now, I thought surveying the audience to find out who's here, and I understand we have some Army officers here, and I always like to check the audience, because last week, I got trapped by 184 chiropractors in here, and as you know, doctors are against them. They don't appreciate chiropractors, and I don't appreciate doctors, so I have this kind of thing about the American Medical Association, which is kind of a progressive group. And I got, right? AMA Journal said a couple of months ago that they spend endless numbers of dollars sending truth teams, that's what they call them, into rural areas where people listen to faith healers and rainmakers and everything. And the AMA is trying to educate people so they won't fall prone to ledger domain by faith healers. And the AMA is against faith healers and any other cure which is rapid. That's their theme, right? I know. Anyway, so I just want to mention that. And what else I want to mention compulsively? Oh, well, anyway, I'm going to talk about... I was sick myself earlier this year, and I was just telling George about this. I was sick, and I had mononucleosis. And I caught it from a girl at Smith College. And, right? I didn't really, but it sounds more interesting. I actually got it from fatigue, but... and it's the same thing in the army. I actually used to get sick by shaking hands, but I'd build a story around it so that people would think. Anyway, so you know what that reference is? Well, I should have put it the other way. I put it in low key. Anyway, most of the time you go to see fellows in the hospital in the army and they'd say, well, shaking hands. But that isn't the way they got it. Anyway, we'll talk about this later. So, anyway, so this is really wild though. I got mononucleosis because I was on this college tour with Dave Brubeck in a quartet. And we played Smith College, and I got involved with this girl. Although they're not unstable at Smith, I don't want to give that impression. But this girl was, first of all, young, you know, and she's like 17, you know. And a lot of people always say, well, a woman can be a woman at 17. I don't think 17 is a graphic enough way to put it. Think of it this way. How many people do you know who were born in 1941? Does that get to you? No, huh? Well, I know, 1941. Think of it this way, or kind of girls, you say to them, they say, 2 weeks ago was December 7th, and they say, what's that? That's the way, see? And then you say, see, then you tell them, and then they say, I never was very good at history. That's when you know. It's a true story. So then these girls don't pick up with any traveling musician, you know, that just comes to play a one-nighter, but then we were doing a concert in the afternoon, too, so you could really build something, right? So then we arrive, and they got 800 girls at Smith, and about 600 of them are on probation, you know. And because they have this eternal light of optimism, they keep talking about graduating, which is, you know, very hopeful of them. And they even talk about what they're going to wear at the ceremony, which is really pushing it, you know. And they keep saying, at graduation, and I keep saying, you know, cesarean, no doubt. But they didn't get the message. It's a lot of that salty. Well... Anyway, so much for relationships, which is that's a psychoanalytic term for sex, I found out. It's relationships, right? When it doesn't work out, it's a relationship. Now back to the material. Now that the holidays are over, this pagan ritual, I don't know how you made out at Christmas. I made out pretty well myself. But the trouble with being an atheist is you don't get any days off. That's what I was going to say, but I won't. Right? And if you're an agnostic, you don't know if you get them off or not. That's right. Anyway... I went to Palm Springs for the holidays. The club was closed here. You know, we gave up finally. And we packed it in. And I split and I went to Palm Springs, and which I didn't dig, although I have a lot of admiration for those people carving out a nation in the desert. Anyway, so I went down there. And then on the way back, I got hung up in that holiday roadblock that the highway patrol had. And, you know, you saw the figures there? That's how they get their budget, see? They said, you know, they stopped so many cars and they put so many... Anyway, according to the Mirror News, the Highway Patrol arrested more people than there are in California, I gather, over the holidays. So it's very exciting. And they got all these people, no gangsters or anything, or security risks, but just a lot of weird people. And I got stopped. I went through the whole scene with the police in Palm Springs. And I got back into town dead, you know, because it was all bawling down there. And nobody had any food. I just went from house to house. And everybody had eggnog and Tom and Jerry's and all that jazz. And my blood sugar is getting lower and the alcoholic content is getting higher. I was falling on my head, you know. So I was listening up-tempo music on the radio and just hanging, you know, and I left the top down so I could breathe. And I was doing pretty good. And I got into town and I got on the freeway. And the freeway was jammed, the Hollywood freeway. I came off the Santa Ana freeway onto the Hollywood freeway in the stack there. And it was jammed, insane, you know. And really wild, and lots of smog. I'm driving in this Austin Healey with the top down. And I got a ticket, which is another thing. I had this ticket which covered the windshield of the Austin Healey. So I got this ticket from this cop. And at the bottom of the ticket, it says illegal parking. And it had this cop's name and number on it, and which I didn't think about. Until later on, I picked up the Mirror News. And Paul Coates has a column in there, an interview with a cop who's given out more tickets than anyone in the world. And it's this cop, this guy's same name, who has given out tickets for 12 years in Civic Center, and he's proud of it. Says he's uncorruptible, and that he's given out tickets to people in his own family and to civic officials, and to, he said, even mail trucks, even though he knows they're exempt, you know, he just writes them up and lays tickets on them, right? And he said, like, a lot of times he works on Saturday, even though he doesn't have to, you know, because he's dedicated. Like this? We have 6,000 policemen in Los Angeles, and they found one who's dedicated, and he's a psychopath. Good? Wonderful. So there's this horrible, this endless interview in which Coates tells him, or asks him what he wants to do with his life, and the cop says, I want to be governor of California, which is a worthy ambition, and I'm going to back him. I wanted to tell you that in 1960, right? And because I think he's honest and uncorruptible, or anything to get him off the streets. That's even right. So anyway, so I'm coming up the freeways, eh? And I'm really screaming. You know, the sports car, a lot of noise, a lot of dirt coming in my face there. And, you know, so the children can write things in your forehead at lights. So I'm flying up the freeway, and I'm doing about 40, but in a sports car, you know, the speed of sound. And I'm going up the freeway, and this guy's in front of me with a truck and trailer. And he pulled ahead of me. He was really screaming for a truck, you know, he was really wailing, and he got ahead of me. So then I was listening to Operation Airwatch. There's this guy in a helicopter on KABC, and he tells you about things. A pretty wild guy, Don Reed and Captain Shoemaker. These two guys are up there, see? And both of them are kind of bitter because they've been on the air for like 6 months, and they can't get into the Academy of Television Arts and Sciences, you know, because a lot of other people performing in TV have a resistance to this new art form of these guys in this helicopter giving traffic conditions. So we're flying up the freeway now, can't breathe in the smog, which Mayor Paulson said came from the bomb tests. And then earlier, J. Edgar Hoover said that Paulson was a communist for saying this, which could hurt Paulson during the election. I wanted to mention that. Or on the other hand, he could cross-file. I wanted to mention that too. So, confused? I mean this to be this confusing, because this is the way it was happening to me, you know? Recapitulation, this is your life. So I'm flying up the freeway, and I'm listening to Don Reed giving traffic conditions, you know, and he tells you what to avoid. Or like he'll say, there's a wild accident, you know, at the DuPont turnoff of the Santa Ana Freeway, and everybody listens and then drives there to see the accident, right? Good. So, oh, we were screaming, you know, we're doing great. So we're going up the freeway, and this guy with a truckload of tomatoes had an accident. He jackknifed the truck and trailer and lost these tomatoes, which are going all over the freeway. And I think it's an indication of the lack of security, you see, because 20 years ago, people would have pulled together and helped him get his tomatoes back to market, you know, or else they would have done a play about it in Federal Theater or something, you know, to be a conscience, I mean. Whereas here, people were running out, you know, very amoral group of women running out there with bags and picking up tomatoes, you know. Well, first they'd feel them, though, right? All right, just checking. So then I get off the Hollywood freeway. Now, it took like 40 minutes from downtown, 6 miles, and I get off the freeway, and I was staggering, and the car is boiling and everything. So I start to go myself, and now it's getting late, see? And this cop starts tailing me, holiday driver, you know? And they only give you warnings around here, generally, because, you know, it's Christmas and all, and you send the police a fifth, and there's a whole thing. Anyway, so I'll tell you about that later. So they give you these warnings, which say, you know, have your accident early. Anyway, so you know about this, don't you? And they were giving, you know, if you cross in front of the crescendo here without the crosswalk, you get a $25 ticket for jaywalking, 25 skins, and there's no way out of it. And it's a moving violation. Did you know that, jaywalking? Like, if you get four, then that's it, you're through, you know? They'll take your shoes away, I suppose. Anyway, what can they do? So, really, insane. So I'm beginning to think the police are the reason for society rather than an outgrowth. You get that feeling? Anyway, so this cop starts tailing me, and he's in his big Mercury, see? And it's the wildest, because I didn't know he was a cop. I went around him, which was stupid. I was speeding to go around him. But for a long time, I'd been guarded, you know? And every time I saw a Mercury, I thought it was a highway patrol, those big Mercs, the Lincoln engines. And I'd see them, and like sometimes it'd just be a guy in a Mercury with his kid, you know? And a kid would lean in the back seat, and his head would look like the light. You know that whole thing? The antenna and all? Right. So my perception was at an all-time low. It's a great imagery tonight. So so then why don't you have any perception? Well, I don't. So anyway, I go around this guy, so he starts tailing me, and he starts tailing me all the way out to Beverly Hills in the Village, you know, for miles. And you know that war of nerves, you know? And he's right on top of you, and you're afraid to go over 25, and you just, you know that thing? And you start playing it too safe, and you start giving signals, you know that, right? You know. And I hate that, you know, you're like gonna crack up, and every time you come to a red light and you stop and put the car in neutral, you know, turn the engine off and put the brake on. Get out and look for trains, right? I know, you know. See, I'm human too. I never can get that impression across, but the only time I appeared human is when my life story ran in the Mirror News 3 weeks ago. They ran my life like it's over. That's a feeling you got. Did you think that? It was very, and they talked about my relationships in there. And they said, they tried to make me sound like a kook, and then I called them, and I said the story was awfully strong. And they said, well, it wouldn't have any interest if we didn't make you sound that way. One of the things they did was they mentioned that I own 38 wristwatches, and 3 sports cars, and 1 that's dismantled, and a dozen rifles, and about 2 dozen pair of binoculars, Japanese and German binoculars, and a lot of cameras are around the house, and high fidelity speaker units and preamps and tuners, junk all over the house. And only thing is, they made it sound like a fetish or something, you know? And I feel on the contrary that if you have enough of these healthy interests, right, that there is no reason you would ever have to develop a relationship with anybody. And that's the way it's working out. I'm just right. Anyway, we'll talk about that later. Hey, speaking of watches, I got a great story to tell you about a watch for a minute. 2 months ago, we had a jazz festival in Monterey, California, of course, up on the peninsula. The first Monterey Jazz Festival. These things come about mainly through the agitating of pressure groups. I mean, there's always a bunch of phonies who are on the board. They have the festival board, and they had it up there. You know, they always have a bad newspaper columnist who reviews movies or something, one of those, you know, have that. And then they have some civic phony, you know, like a car dealer who's in a panic and needs publicity or something. You know, your Nash and Hudson dealer who sells Opals and Renaults in order to stay open. Anyway, those guys. So, you know about this? Very weird. So that's because there's supposed to be a recession. There's a popular opinion that there's been a recession, but we know that that isn't true. The president said it wasn't true in his Christmas message, which you may have heard, right? Merry Christmas and get me down from here, right? Anyway, so, from outer space. Anyway, the theme was that there was a recession. Although I've never commented on the recession because I think it's, you know, it defeats people if you talk that way. So I just said that there's a movie coming out called On the Beach, as you may read, all about the dropping of 4,700. It's being made by Stanley Kramer in a hurry before the world beats him to it in the market. Anyway, it's about this hydrogen war, which results in only 8 people being left alive on Earth, and 4 of them are out of work, right? All right, anyway. Don't feel bad. I have a lot of jokes that are only for college people. I read in Esquire magazine this month, they claim that my appeal is mainly for college folk. You won't be able to tell tonight because there aren't any here. They're all at the post office, right? For the next week. That's what they'll be. And you won't get any of your mail as a result. And they're the worst. The Bureau of Occupations, when I was at the University of California, would send you to the post office over Christmas. Or if you had a blue suit, you could go to Robinson's and sell clocks. But otherwise, you have to work at the post office. And then you have to, you know about the post office? It's great. You have to take the oath and you get a bond and you get a pass and you get this leg guard for dogs. You know, might bite your leg. And you say, you know, I swear to take this mail, and you get that tradition and everything. And then you walk out of the back of the post office, go around the corner and throw it in a sewer. You know, say, I don't have to carry this advertising. I'm going to be an engineer in 2 weeks. Right? Then finals came and they curved me. Didn't use any of the questions from the book. All right, so anyway, school was really boring, wasn't it? Well, anyway, onward. So getting back to Monterey, what does this have to do with Monterey? Well, so the Jazz Festival Board, which is made up of a used car dealer, a bad newspaper columnist, a priest, and a junkie. Anyway, all of right? American jazz. They decided that jazz should have a homecoming. And the purpose of this was, they're not only going to have the first West Coast Jazz Festival, but it'll be a welcome home to all the groups that played overseas for the State Department. And the State Department has a tendency to send jazz groups over, mainly to Arabia, to overcome the Little Rock thing. See, they send racially mixed groups. Well, we got a lot of bad headlines over there, and the Arabs, for some unknown reason, have a tendency, I understand, to identify with colored peoples and their plight, even though we've told the Arabs they're just like us. They won't listen. So, all right, you know about this? It's great. So, they just won't listen to reason. So, the voice of reason. Anyway. They're having this jazz festival. So I got a letter from the festival board and said, report to the International Airport at 8 in the morning. We're flying all the musicians up. This was on TWA, which had not gone out on strike as yet. Then they went out because of the mechanics, and now American is out now because of the pilots who got into a big panic about a raise and also about the fact that the guys in the baggage room were wearing wings and they got hacked about it. You know about this? They're all... A lot of stewardesses around for dates, though. It's a group, right? So, I know. Good girls. So anyway, onward. And, right? And when you drive them home, they put on their heels before they get out of the car. Flats while you're driving. All right. So, anybody fly? All right. So anyway, we get down there and we're at the TWA terminals, eh? And everybody's standing around waiting for the plane. And the first sign I get of what this is going to be like is that all the tickets that were picked up there for the airplane by the Monterey Jazz Festival Board are all, they're all tourist tickets. They fly the musicians behind that curtain. TWA has ingeniously divided the plane and you ride in the back behind this curtain and you don't get dinner. But it's cheaper, and there's good and bad in it. You know, you don't see the stewardess at all. She doesn't, you know, there isn't even water back there. There's about four seats across, and but it's cheaper. And on the other hand, you land places later if you think about it that way, because you're in back. So we get there, and everybody's walking around with drums and everything. I say, when does the plane leave? Well, it's late. Good, good start, morale. So what do you do? Well, you can go to the Ambassador Lounge. They've made preparations here, arrangements, and they're ready. That is lounge, which I should commend TWA for, because American and United would never think of anything like this. They have a lounge for million-mile passengers. It's pretty groovy, you know, in the family style. And you can go up there and you can talk, you know, and kill time. You can talk to the hostess or write letters to your mother if you're that kind of a person. Or what else can you do? Oh, there's a bar. That's kind of wild for some people. And you can have a couple of drinks, you know, and see your plane take off toward the end of the afternoon. Right? All right. So we get on the plane, and we get to the festival. So I get off the festival, and the festival is insane. You can't find any musicians. They're just all these kooks walking around, critics, and people taking pictures of each other. Everybody takes pictures at jazz festivals, up close, out of focus, you know, art, low grain. So they're all walking around, and all the advertising people have got this Ginza, this veritable bazaar of activity, and the Ampex people are there with tape recorders and a jack in each ear, you know, two-channel stereo. And some maniac is there displaying how with $139 he built this Heath kit, except they don't give you a speaker, you know. So, you know, we're moving the family into the garage and using the house as a speaker. You know those people? Great. So the festival starts, and the musicians start, and Brubeck was late. Brubeck got there. That made it a festival. See, it's not a festival until Dave arrives. See, he arrived, and he had just come from the Arab League. He'd been over there for 21 weeks for the State Department, and there's a great confusion in the popular mind between jazz and the State Department, which is in evidence in the latest issue of Playboy magazine in their jazz poll in the Christmas issue, where you'll notice that a lot of confused people have put Dulles' name in these categories, you know? And he's very high on miscellaneous instruments, for instance, right? The panic button. All right. So Brubeck gets off the plane, and I hadn't seen him like in 6 months. I said, oh, you know, what's happening? What do you do for the State Department? So he said, basically what they do is sort of follow Dulles and make up with these people from country to country. So, thank you. So, oh, yeah? So... I gather you're not altogether on the side of the Secretary of State. The President had a great quote when he was asked at the press conference whether or not Dulles would resign. I think the quote was, I wouldn't have him resign for the world. Did you read that? So he does know what the stakes are, really, right? Okay. You know, Dulles predicted that over Christmas the Red Chinese would invade Quy Moi, and they didn't. And, right, because they couldn't get past the American supplies on the beach. All right, see the boxes. Great. Well, we've invested a lot of money over there. We have $90 million worth of aid went to Chiang in something like 3 weeks, while at the same time the public school bill was vetoed. And that would sound inconsistent on the surface, but it's okay, because we find upon investigation that before Chiang received any of the money, he assured the president that he wouldn't spend any of it on schools. So it's okay, right? Good. We'll get back to schools later. So we don't need school. All right. So anyway, it's great. So Brubeck started a play and broke it up, did very well musically. And then afterwards, I talked to him on the way back to the plane, because it was a real fasty. We just went up there for the afternoon. And we talked about the Middle East trip. And he said that they'd done, you know, they'd been in Lebanon, a lot of wild places. And they said that, see, the idea is that Brubeck has had a group for 8 years, and yet the State Department did not send them over until he mixed his group racially. And that goes over big with the Arabs, he said. See, they have these kind of... they have relatively short performances, like an hour, and then they have like a four-hour reception, diplomatically, a party, and everybody drinks and eats crackers and talks about brotherhood. So then the musicians come, and then the Arabs who dig jazz go up to the musicians and say things like, how did you get into jazz? Because they dig that, you know? And then the musicians have a chance to say things like, well, it's funny. When I was a kid, I wanted to be a doctor, but when the schools closed in my state, I had to get into something else, you see? So, so then, great. So now, thank you. So now we go back to the plane, and we're getting on the plane, and the festival board gave Dave a watch. They gave him a watch for his performance, which is great. And they gave him this crazy watch. It's a bomb. It's called a repeater, and it has a big chime in it. Really great, you know? And it plays the time in different 12-tone scale, and you hear the time. And it's pretty groovy, like if you're on a plane or something at night, and you can't see. You know, you can just press this thing, you hear the time. It's great. And he dug it, and all the way back to Los Angeles, we were on this plane at night, and Dave was like wrapped up in the watch, and he'd keep pressing it to hear the time, and then he'd put on a light and check it, and then he'd press it, you know, and listen, he'd put on a light and check it again, and it went on all the way down, and the board said that if the festival went well next year, they'd give him another watch for his right arm, and then he'd have stereo, which no one has yet, right? Exciting, huh? All right, now, before I go, I want to mention that on the we're almost out of time. That on the next show, I'm going to talk about actors because I just got to be an actor myself, and I'm going to be doing some work for the Columbia Broadcasting System again. And I work for all the networks now except ABC, which you might be. That's kind of an interesting network, sort of an enigma in television. They ABC just announced that they were going to do 12 spectaculars on the Civil War, one a month. There's a big interest in that in this country. And there are people who keep sand tables and little soldiers and everything. So, really, you know, so they're going to do 12 spectaculars in color tracing the history of the Civil War, one a month, which is pretty ambitious. And that cost a lot of money, no matter how they did it, you know, whether they did it on videotape, a new process, or on film. Or if they wait 6 months, they can do it live as a remote. I was thinking about that.